The X-Zone radio and TV show is largely an opinion talk show. All opinions, comments, or statements of fact expressed by Rob McConnell's guests are strictly their own and are not to be construed as those of the X-Zone radio and TV show or in any manner endorsed by Rob McConnell, rel-mar McConnell Media Company, Talkstar Radio Network, its affiliated stations, or employees.
Welcome to the X Zone, a place where fact is fiction and fiction is reality. Now, here's your host, Rob McConnell.
Back to the X-Zone, everyone. My name's Rob McConnell, and you're listening to us live and around the world on the Talkstar Radio Network. Our toll-free number is 1-877-528-8255. That's toll-free throughout the U.S., Canada, Alaska, and Hawaii. My email address is xzone@talkstarradio.com. On MSN Messenger, you can chat with us here in our studios in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada, by using the MSN address talkstarradio@hotmail.com. At our website, www.xzoneradio.com. Joining me now is Terry James. He is the editor of RaptureReady.com. He's also the author of the Nephilim Imperatives. He is a prophecy expert and lecturer. He is also the general editor of RaptureReady.com, the number one prophecy website on the Internet. Founded in 1989, the website receives more than 8 million visitors each month and has more than 4,000 active members. Now, one of the main site's main features is the Rapture Index, a constantly updating gauge that measures end-time issues and events in the news. Any event that has biblically prophetic relevance is assigned a ranking. The combined ranking serves as an end-time speedometer, signaling the speed at which the world is moving towards Armageddon. And, Terry, are we heading towards Armageddon?
Well, yes, eventually. The Bible says that anyway, and I come from a biblical worldview, so in my view, yes, we're headed toward Armageddon.
Are we in the biblical end times?
Well, I think we are, according to the signals that I believe that God's Word tells us, as far as Old Testament, New Testament prophets are concerned. I think certainly Israel being back in the land is a nation again, speaking a single language.
You're going to have to speak up, sir. We're having a problem hearing you over here.
Oh, well, okay, I'll try.
There you
better?
Go. Much better, thank you.
I was saying that Israel being back in the land, I think, is the number one signal that shows where we are on God's prophetic timeline. And I do think that that signals, according to God's word, that we're in prophetic times.
Can the end times be stopped?
Well, no. I mean, I think that things are in motion, and I don't know when that's going to be. I mean, it could be a day, a year, or 100 years, but if we believe in God's word, which I do, and that's the worldview I come from, I think that it's going to play out just as God prophesied through his prophets. No, the answer is no. I don't think it can be stopped.
All right, Terry, what is the number one issue on Rapture, your website?
the number one issue? That's a good question. I think it's probably the very issue of Israel, because that's what we get the most commentary on. That's what most people are concerned with, and that's probably because we as prophecy teachers teach that Israel being back in the land is the number one signal, and the fact that there's a peace process, which is at the center of Bible prophecy, as being significant for the last days, is really something that our people who come to Rapture Ready look for, I think, is the nation Israel being back in the land. And of course, this peace process is very important to the tribulation era, that last 7 years, we believe, of history that I guess the Catholic Church calls the apocalypse.
Terry James, please stand by. We have to take a two-minute commercial break. Terry's website is www.raptureready.com, and the name of his book is Nephilim Imperatives, Dark Sentences. Terry and I will be back after this commercial break in 2 minutes as the X-Zone continues live and around the world from our studios in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada, exclusively around the world on the Talkstar Radio Network. Don't go away.
I told you, homeboy, you can't touch this. Yeah, that's how we living, and you know, you can't touch this.
Rob McConnell here, presenting an overview for Nicholas Paul Jennings, author of a fascinating book, Amen. It presents facts revealed by Egyptologists, facts that enable us to understand why Amen is the beginning of creation of God. It provides recommendations for religious leaders of the major religions to unify their beliefs and teach the Word of God, love one another. Amen informs people how mankind conceived God. It was the Egyptians that developed the concepts of a soul, a hereafter, and son of God. And finally, after the worship of many gods, they conceived the belief in one universal God, the maker of all there is. For more information, visit www.futureofgodamen.com. That's www.futureofgodamen.com. Named one of the world's greatest psychics, Elizabeth Joyce is now giving readings worldwide via Skype. Elizabeth Joyce is recognized for her clairvoyant ability to help find missing persons, her analysis of dreams, past life regression work, mediumship, and her accurate predictions. Elizabeth has been a frequent guest on the X-Zone radio show with yours truly, Rob McConnell, now for several years. For an appointment with Elizabeth Joyce, call 201-934-8986 or Skype at elizabeth.joyce. And for more information, you can always visit Elizabeth Joyce online at www.new-visions.com.
Terry James is our special guest. And Terry, what do UFOs have to do with Bible prophecy?
Well, that's one of the signals, I believe. Jesus said that as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the days of the Son of Man, in Luke 17, chapter 17, verse 26, 27. And we look back to what was going on in Noah's day, in the pre-antediluvian, or the antediluvian time, before the flood, pre-flood days. One of the things in Genesis chapter 6 was that the angels of God, the fallen angels, the one-third that left in the rebellion with Lucifer, looked down and saw the daughters of men, flesh and blood men, that they were fair.
Mm-hmm.
And it said that they came to earth and took to wife everyone that they chose. From those unions came the offspring, the Nephilim, or the giants of old, and from that, I believe many of the legends and lore of old were born, the Greek and Norse mythology and the Roman mythology and so forth. So Jesus said it would be that way again. There would be another visitation of these creatures. And so I have a view, and I wrote it in a fictional form, but based upon a Bible view, that the sightings and things we see are not extraterrestrial, but they're interdimensional. That is, they're demonic activity to deceive and to delude mankind for several reasons. One of the reasons being that that they do not act in a physical way. All we know is a physical universe. We don't know of any other physics than what science has shown us. And these things act so much differently than physics as we know them that, for instance, human astronauts could not go at right angles and things at the speed they go without completely crushing them. And so based upon that, the UFOs being able to appear, disappear, to take off from a standstill to a sudden just a phenomenally fast rate, and then I think that smacks more of a supernatural than a natural or physical thing. So I kind of work that into the fictional account too, and doing it from a Bible perspective again.
Now, if you're doing everything on a fictional basis, are you saying that the Bible is fiction?
Better than that. I didn't say that at all. Didn't imply it. No, not at all. I just think sometimes it's good to, I wanted to write fiction, and in this particular case, but I think it's something that's in the Bible that's truth, because I think all Bible is truth, and I decided to make a story that that would get a truth across.
Now, prior to writing your book, had you had any experience with UFOs? Have you ever seen a UFO?
No, I haven't. I'm blind to begin with. But before I lost my eyesight, I certainly never saw one, no.
All right, so do you think that there is a conspiracy, the government or someone is covering up the truth about UFOs?
Well, I think there's some cover-up because so many things have not been explained, and rather than coming forth with these, with any explanation that makes a lot of sense, they choose to keep it covert, black ops type things. So I think that they feed the desire to know, maybe the UFO hysteria or whatever. So I think there's a certain amount of covering up, and whether it's for defense purposes or what, I don't know, but that certainly feeds conspiratorial thoughts.
Now, do you believe that these beings, whatever or whomever they are about to invade the planet Earth?
I believe they're here, and they've always been here since the Garden of Eden, when Lucifer came and then became Satan, tempted man. Man fell in the garden, and I think they're demonic beings that have always been here and will be here until Christ returns, and then they are no longer here.
Why is it that whenever something wants to give us information, give us knowledge, it's classified as demonic?
Well, I don't know. Am I supposed to answer that? I don't know.
What's
the question?
No, I'm just...
I don't know.
Humans want to learn.
Is that always the case? I haven't noticed that.
Well, you know, I'm just taking this from your conversation where, you know, that the knowledge that was tried to be given to us in the Garden of Eden was classified as demonic or evil. And I'm just wondering why everyone, and I'm asking you since you wrote a book on the subject, why knowledge given to man or mankind is considered evil.
Well, I didn't know that that was the case. I never thought that. Okay. I think God is the provider of knowledge, and I don't think that's evil.
So if it doesn't come from God, then it's evil.
Well, yeah, I would say there's two forces in the world. There's God and there's the devil, and there's good and there's evil. Mm-hmm. So in that case, yes.
Now, obviously, a lot of people say that they are seeing UFOs. So why do you think the government doesn't want to tell us about these UFOs if, in fact, they're really here?
There again, I don't know. I think maybe to prevent panic. I don't know. That's a good question, because it seems like they would want to come forth and explain things if they could, if there was an explanation to be given. Certainly, there must be some legitimate sightings, because they're doing programs, documentary programs. They've had news programs. For goodness sakes, Peter Jennings, before he died, did a major documentary on them. So there's obviously something there. It's not all aberration. So,
but if there's really something there, how come more people don't see them, and why are the sightings decreasing in numbers these days?
Well, I don't think they're decreasing. I think you're wrong there. I think they are increasing. They're just... they may not make the mainstream news every day, but...
Is that because mainstream news and media takes it more seriously than the fringe and the Internet people do? Because on the Internet, you can say anything and people will believe you, whereas if it goes into the mainstream media, it's verified, it's checked, and a lot of the stories that are promoted through the Internet really have no business on mainstream news, because it's all a bunch of bunk.
Okay, well, that's your opinion.
You don't agree?
Well, I don't agree or disagree. You made a statement, and you stick by it. I'm just telling you that I believe in that UFOs do exist, but that they're interdimensional, not extraterrestrial.
But can I ask you this then, sir?
Sure.
How do you know they exist if you've never seen one?
Because I have faith. I believe what the Bible says, and I think that the Bible tells us that these things will again come to planet Earth and will again affect mankind. And I think it's plainly demonic activity based upon fallen angels and their interaction with mankind. Jesus said it would happen again. It's based upon faith. I believe God's word.
And things
are, well, let me finish. Since these things are manifesting themselves in sightings and so forth, well, I think that's what they are. That's my opinion.
All right, then, let me ask you this. Are we alone in the universe? Did God just create man, or did he create other people in other planets, in other solar systems?
I don't know. Am I supposed to answer that?
Why not? You wrote the book. I didn't.
Well, I know, but how is a finite human being supposed to answer something like that? I don't know. There's no record of it, so I don't know.
Then who is coming to visit us?
The demons.
Who created the demons?
Satan did in his fall in the garden.
All right, who created Satan?
God. He created the angels. In the Bible, it's called the mystery of iniquity. It's another finite question that infinite question that the finite mind cannot answer.
Now, if we could answer that, then we would have the same knowledge of God, and if we had the same knowledge of God, then we would be a threat to the very existence of God, because we would no longer fear, and we would understand, and therefore God would have no valid existence in our world.
Is that right? Well, okay. If that's your opinion, I won't argue with that. I just I don't know where you're going with it, but
you don't know where I'm going with it.
No. Okay. Tell me more about it.
Tell you more about it. All right. The way that I see it is that God said, "Let us create man in our image." He used the plural. He didn't use the singular. A lot of people say that's because it is the Holy Trinity. That is the we. What happens if God is not a single person, but a civilization that visited this planet thousands and thousands and thousands of years ago? Greek mythology is much older than Christianity. It's the, you know, it parallels Christianity. In fact, Christianity took a lot of its events from Greek mythology. We call Greek mythology a myth, and yet we call Christianity a religion. I think that this is a little turned around sometimes. I believe that God created men in his own image because of DNA work. Noah, you see, if I was to write the Bible, I would have Noah first, because Noah, in my humble opinion, was not the captain of an ark. He was the captain of a spaceship. And then all the animals, two by two, was DNA. Let's talk more when we come back from this commercial break. 1-877-528-8255 is toll-free throughout the U.S., Canada, Alaska, and Hawaii. Give me a call, Exo Nation. Ask our very special guest questions. The name of his book is The Nephilim Imperatives, Dark Sentences. His name is Terry James. His website is www.raptureready.com. 1-877-528-8255 is toll-free. And I'll be back on the other side of this news break with some fine words from our sponsors as we continue live and around the world. We're right here on the Talkstar Radio Network.
I know you've heard me talk about Margie Garrison, the arthritis lady, but have I told you about the time she was thrown out of an arthritis convention for telling the truth that most arthritis sufferers attending that convention didn't need the expensive and maybe dangerous drugs and treatments they were being sold? Man alive, did they hustle her out of there pronto? This might not work for absolutely everybody, but if you get Mrs. Garrison's program and give it a try for a year and it doesn't end up ending most of your pain, ask for your money back. Look it up for yourself online at healthstarproducts.com. That's H-E-A-L-T-H, healthstarproducts.com. See what the doctors are saying about Mrs. Garrison's program and if this works for you or a member of your family.
It's the most wonderful time.
Have you heard about the holiday gift Premier Psychics is giving to all their first-time callers? In addition to 10 minutes for the low price of $25, Premier Psychics is offering a holiday greeting special that allows any first-time caller to receive a full 10 minutes for free after their initial 10-minute call. So call Premier Psychics now, sign up for 10 minutes for only $25, and they will see 10 free minutes added to your account at the end of your first call to them. Call Premier Psychics today. 1-866-803-6593 or visit Premier Psychics online at www.premierpsychics.com. A very Merry Christmas and the best of the new year to one and all from Premier Psychics, where the extra E in Premier stands for excellence.
Once again, that toll-free number is 1-866-803-6593 or visit Premier Psychics online at www.premierpsychics.com.
Do you have a disease that you would like to alleviate through a natural means? Have you been contacted by angels, ghosts, or even extraterrestrials and want to validate these experiences? Or would you simply like to speak with someone who can help you find your life's purpose? I'm Dr. Joseph Mara, and I'm offering my services free of charge for first-time clients contacting me during the month of April. These free consultations include angel card readings, guided meditations, life coaching, and energy healing. If you have always wanted to explore these types of experiences but were skeptical or simply could not afford them, then take advantage of this free special offer. Contact me through my website, aguidinglight.com, to schedule your consultation today. Until then, I offer you love, light, and laughter.
If you enjoy reading a good mystery with a touch of the paranormal, then you'll love From Out of the Woodwork by William S. Peckham. Sean Kennedy, a Toronto contractor, buys derelict houses, guts them, and turns them into multifamily dwellings. when Sean buys 29 Livery Lane, a century house in ruins, and starts the renovation, the house fights back. He is visited by ghosts of owners past. His visions are triggered by touching an oak mantle, reading a faded letter, opening an old locket, or opening a brand new casket in the basement. These visions will take you on a trip across southern Ontario from Niagara Falls to Toronto to Kingston. From Out of the Woodwork is now available in paperback and on your favorite electronic reader. To order your copy of From Out of the Woodwork, go to www.williamspeckham.com. That's
www.williamspeckham.com.
Well, I just got back from Roswell, where the aliens have been. And if you ask the feds the cause, well, they'll only lie again. Now I'm hunted by the gumshoes, and I'm wanted by the cops, 'cause they think that I might be the guy making circles in the crops. And I know that there's a conspiracy from the voices in my head. Elvis lives, that's clear to me. It's McCartney who is dead. And if the Mars man should come again and take me, I will go. I will take a trip on their rocket ship. God bless the UFO. Give JFK this message. It's the Cuban Army's fault. And I know that Dave Koresh is alive inside a vault. We've seen reports in papers of a guy who knows about a car that runs on chewing gum, but the Arabs rubbed him out. We loudly warn that America is badly unprepared. With the Cold War through, we need something new that can get you good and scared. You wonder just who is warning you of conspiracies today. We're the ones who fill the rumor mill. We are the CIA.
Love to an alien near Roswell last night. We strolled along together in the pale moonlight. I had a funny feeling that something wasn't right. I made love to an alien last night. When she gripped my hand, I was feeling mighty fine.
Terry James is our guest this hour, www.raptorready.com. He's the author of the Nephilim Imperatives. And Terry, why did you? What was your inspiration to write this book?
Well, I think that I do believe that this is one area of Bible prophecy that has mm-hmm. been neglected by Bible prophecy people, by scholars and by broadcasters, by teachers, by writers. And I think that this is one area that needs to be dealt with, the thing, the spiritual activity that I believe the Bible predicts will be prevalent at the end of the age, which I believe we're bumping up against. So I wanted to address it, and I wanted to do it in a way that would perhaps tell the story through fiction, and that's why I chose to do it that way. So it's just addressing a topic I think that needs addressing, and that is that that Jesus said, he gave a specific prophecy, as it was in the days of Noah, so will it be in the day when he returns. And I think we're beginning to see the manifestation of some of that demonic spiritual activity. That's based upon Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, by the Apostle Paul, who said, we struggle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. So that was the sort of the nucleus or matrix out of which the fiction grew.
I see. Now, this novel is almost written, in part at least, from personal experiences. What of your personal experiences have you woven into the story?
Well, it's the part of my being in the Air Force in 1967, seeing the president come into Randolph Air Force Base at least every other weekend, President Johnson, to fly to Bergstrom Air Force Base in a smaller jet to go to LBJ Ranch. Mm-hmm. And I just use that as sort of a nucleus for the UFO stuff. Instructor pilot there, T-38, high performance jet training. And I kind of built it from there, kind of beginning there, with this pilot having experiences with UFOs and different things in different flight conflicts that he fought in. So my experience would base basically just a kind of a geographical thing there.
What would you like readers to get out of your book? What's the message you're trying to get across?
Well, the number one message I try to get across in all my work is that Jesus Christ is the Savior of the world. He came to earth to die for the sins of man, and anyone who accepts Christ for salvation will spend eternity in heaven with God the Father. And that's what the Bible teaches. That's the basic gospel message. So everything I do is geared around that.
Okay, now, do you believe in other strange phenomenon like ghostly hauntings, stigmata reports, apparitions?
Well, I believe they're happening. I don't know what percentage of them are real, what percentage of them are demonically inspired, what percentage are, just plain kooksville. I don't know. But I do believe there's some basis to these things. I think there are some not hauntings. I don't believe there are any hauntings because I believe the Bible teaches that it's appointed unto man once to die and after death the judgment. So I don't believe souls come back to haunt. But I do believe that demonic activity can delude people into thinking they're being haunted.
Do you believe that people see apparitions of those who they have loved in this dimension after they pass?
I believe that they are deluded. Some people may be deluded into thinking that. They won't be their true lost loved ones, but I believe that Satan and his minions can cause people to deludedly believe that. I believe they have the power to do that in some cases, yeah, and I believe they have done that in some cases, but I don't think it's maybe as prolific as maybe someone would like to have it, but I do believe it has happened.
I find that strange since you believe in UFOs or interdimensional travel, and yet when it comes to other phenomena like ghosts who statistically have shown over the years that more people believe in ghosts than in UFOs.
I understand that, but I don't. It's a difference between beliefs. I mean, what the Bible says, it says that the dead do not come back to life.
Then how come Jesus came back to life after he was crucified?
I'm sorry, what?
Then if the Bible says the dead don't come back to life, how do you explain the resurrection?
Jesus did not come back to life as a ghost. He came back resurrected in full bodily form.
But he came back from the dead.
That was Christ. He's God.
So if we're made in God's image, why can't we do that?
We can, but we can't do it until it's God's time to resurrect the dead. That hasn't happened yet.
It seems to be
except in a couple of cases, and it was to prove Jesus' deity when he raised Lazarus, for example.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I guess what you're trying to say is that the people who are claiming that they're seeing ghosts are actually partaking in a demonic experience?
Yes.
Interesting. Okay, let me see. Your biography mentions the JAWS program, the computer software technology that assists you in your work. Can you tell us about that?
Yes, as I said, I've been blind since 1993 due to a retinal degenerative disease called retinitis pigmentosa.
Mm-hmm.
And I used to dictate my manuscript and so forth on standard cassettes and then have my editor would type them out, transcribe them, and then we would edit them by phone. But I went to a state program, actually, to show the JAWS program, which is a computer program that it will play that synthesized voice, will play back every keystroke you put in, whether it's a word, a sentence, a paragraph, or an entire document. And it becomes kind of second nature to you, like riding that proverbial bicycle. Mm. It's just something that you just pick up, and it the ear picks it up, and it becomes almost like a second sight to you. And so it's increased our production as far as writing work is concerned by, 1,000% or so, because it takes out all those other steps. I can just type everything in and then send it by computer to my editor, who then can put it into finished form. And so it's a really great instrument. I would recommend anybody in your audience who might be blind and want to find a really good word system to use with computer, this is excellent. Jobs Accessible Word System, the acronym, of course, JAWS, J-A-W-S.
That's a fascinating system. Tell me, Terry, how long did it take you to write your book?
This last book?
Yes.
About 6 months, this one. And my previous one, The Rapture Dialogues, which is the first book of the series. I took about 8 months to write that one, about 6 months to write the second one.
Now, the Nephilim Imperatives ends in a way which could be considered a cliffhanger that begs for a sequel. Are you planning other novels?
Yes, I plan at least one more of the series, maybe two, but at least one more. But I'm going to have to get some nonfiction writing out of the way first mm-hmm. before I can start that.
What do you think will happen at the final day? What does your belief tell you will happen?
Final day, I mean, meaning what? Final day of what?
The final day of this earth as we know it.
As we know it right now, this earth age. Well, I believe in dispensational belief that God has dealt with man in various dispensations. For example, the Adamic age, and then after the flood, and then the Noahic age, and then the Abrahamic age. In other words, he's dealt down through the years with different ages of mankind. And we're right now, I believe, in the church age. That's the age between the time the church was born, mm-hmm. Pentecost, in chapter 2 of Acts, the church of Jesus Christ, the church he said he would found, the Christian church. So we're in that, we've been in that for 2,000 years, just about. So at the end of this particular age, I believe the Bible teaches in 1 Thessalonians, 1 Corinthians, a rapture of the church, a sudden snatching up of believers into heaven. And that's what's going to happen. That ends the church age. Mm-hmm. The church will be gone, all born-again believers. And then we'll begin the next stage, which will be the age of tribulation, or the Catholics would have it, the apocalypse. And most of that is covered in the book of Revelation. And that'll be a seven-year period Jesus said it would be a time such as was not since the beginning of time to that time that he was telling it, nor would ever be again. It would be such a horrible time of God's judgment. And so that'll run for 7 years. And that's initiated not by the rapture of the church, but by the signing of a peace covenant between Israel and its enemy neighbors. And it'll involve the whole world, as a matter of fact, this peace treaty will. And this peace covenant, the Antichrist will sign this peace covenant. And that's what sets in motion the tribulation the last 7 years of human history. And in it, at the last day of that 7 years period, well, Christ will return, it says in Revelation chapter 9, verse 11, at Armageddon, just as mankind is about to destroy himself, Christ will come back to put an end to this war campaign called Armageddon, and he will set up then we begin the millennial age, 1,000 years reign of Christ, which is the next dispensation. And then following that, at the very end of that, is all things come to a consummation. Mm-hmm. The end is finally reached. God is going to, the Bible says in Revelation, is going to remake the heavens and the earth by supernatural fire. All will be recreated, and it'll be a new heavens and a new earth.
Now, those who remain, for example, what will happen to Satan?
Satan, following the tribulation, he will be loosed. He is loosed now, and it says that in 1 Peter 5:8 that beware the devil, because he goes about stalking like a lion, roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. So he's loose on the earth now. That's the reason for all of the horror on the earth.
But after the apocalypse, what happens to Satan at that time?
Okay, Satan, well, yeah, okay, we're going to move right forward to that. Well, he is bound at the end of the tribulation, the apocalypse. He is bound by an angel with supernatural chains. He's put in the bottomless pit, it says. He and his minions, all of the minions, there'll be no Satan or his fallen angels during that thousand-year reign of Christ that follows the apocalypse. And he will be in a bottomless pit for a thousand years. But at the very end of that thousand years, he will be loosed, the Bible says, from the bottomless pit. Why? I don't know.
Man.
You know, I don't know why he let him loose in the first place. So I don't know why he'll let him loose in the second place.
I guess a question that's always got me is, why hasn't somebody from heaven just taken Lucifer out by now?
Because it's just in God's plan. It's just not run its course yet. It's like some drama. I can't explain it. It's super. It's beyond the finite mind to explain. I just accept it because I believe what God's Word says. I agree. I mean, that would seem like that would have been the thing that a logical human constabulary would do, would take out the bad guy.
Yeah.
But the fact is, according to the Bible, he's going to be loosed into the end of that thousand years, and he's going to instantly have a follower of literally millions upon millions of people who will then follow him as he leads an attack upon Jerusalem, and where Christ has his very throne. And then fire from heaven will simply put an end to it, to all of these people. And that's what the Bible says. And beyond that, anything I said would be strictly speculation, just what God's Word says. That's what I believe.
All right, Terry, stand by. You and I have to take our final break for this hour. Terry James is our special guest, www.raptureready.com. And Terry and I will be back on the other side of this commercial set. Still to come on tonight's show, we have Reddick Harris, who's going to be joining me, talking about the X-Zone Book Club. And then in our final hour, Ellen from Premier Psychics will be doing psychic readings for one and all who give us a call at 1-877-528-8255. My name's Rob McConnell. This is the X-Zone, and we're coming to you live and around the world from our studios in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada, exclusively on TalkStar.
I can't walk.
I can walk, but not very far.
I can't even stand anymore.
And it gave me no freedom.
If you or a loved one suffer from limited mobility, we have incredible news. Now you may qualify for your very own new Invacare power chair or scooter at little or no cost to you. Call Mobility Products Unlimited right now to begin your free pre-qualification process. Invacare's powered mobility products are comfortable, stylish, easy to maneuver, and go anywhere.
And yes, you can get back out there too. With Invacare.
So pick up the phone and call Mobility Products right now, risk-free. Their friendly specialists handle all the paperwork and make it fast and easy to begin the pre-qualification process for your very own Invacare power chair or scooter. You could get yours within just days. There's no pressure, no obligation, no cost for the call. And your satisfaction is guaranteed.
So if you're stuck at home, call 1-800-594-5356 right now. Friendly mobility specialists are standing by.
Whether it's the arrival of Planet X in 2012, the Earth's crazy weather cycles, our deadly global warming, Armageddon, UFOs, ETs, terrorism, the critical mass 2008 presidential elections, Dr. Jason Rand talks the talk and walks the walk. Being a twice nominated Grammy record producer, recording artist, publisher, lecturer, UFO ET researcher and investigator, and best-selling author of
The Return of Planet X, Mankind's Ongoing Legacy with a Brown Dwarf Star.
Dr. Jason Rand truly does walk the walk and talk the talk. For more information on Dr. Jason Rand or to order The Return of Planet X, visit his website at www.returnofplanet-x.com or call 901-336-9660.
And where will you be in the year 2012?
I'm William S. Peckham. If you enjoy a good mystery with a touch of the paranormal, then you'll love my novel, From Out of the Woodwork. It's the story of a young Toronto contractor, Sean Kennedy, who buys derelict homes guts them, and turns them into multifamily dwellings. Slums just waiting to happen. When Sean buys 29 Livery Lane, the house fights back. Former owners unexpectedly come out of the woodwork as he starts the destruction. The apparitions come to him when he touches old books, reads hidden letters, rummages through old boxes, finds a locket or reads a discovered manuscript of a murder mystery. From out of the woodwork will take you from 1899 to the horror of the World Trade Center, September 11, 2001. Check out From Out of the Woodwork on my website, www.williamspeckham.com.
The new nonfiction book, Razor of Madness, is similar to cult movies like Clockwork Orange, Dragon's Tattoo, or The Other Side of Hell. Wayne Morin Jr. and Thomas Lee Howe will expose widespread and systematic deficiencies in this thought-provoking tell-all novel. Mind control rages among scholars and law schools. Human rights are ignored while thought reform and mental manipulation are accepted practices used as behavior modification. Dr. Louis Jolyon West comes to mind. Media and public scrutiny shows that United States mental hospitals are in fact destructive murder industries. Razor of Madness expose novel details this epidemic through an in-depth professional and personal investigation. For decades, there has been a revolving door policy that still releases killers and pedophiles back into society. The maestro of mind control continues to haunt America to this very day. Razor of Madness is available in paperback or as a downloadable ebook at Amazon.com.
Still to come on tonight's show, Reddick Harris is going to be joining me after the news to talk about the X-Zone Book Club. And then Ellen will be joining us from Premier Psychics. And their website is www.premierpsychics.com. And this portion of the X-Zone is being brought to you by Technon, the science of survival. When danger strikes, are you going to be prepared? Visit their website at www.technonllc.com. Terry James is the author of The Nephilim Imperatives, and I've always wondered that if evil and demonic and satanic negativity does exist, why is this part of the plan? If God has the ability to wipe out evil, if God has the ability to get rid of Satan, if God has the ability to cure the sick, if God has the ability to feed the hungry, if God has the ability to stop wars, why doesn't he?
Well, that implies a blame on God. And God, we're told in the Bible, is perfect. How can a perfect God create imperfection? Well, he doesn't create imperfection, but there's this thing called the mystery of iniquity that, again, the finite, the infinite, cannot be explained by the finite. I don't know the answers to your questions. That's the reason God's word and people who believe in it is based upon faith.
But don't you have the right to ask these questions?
And, oh yeah, and often and you know, as we have debates about that. We have questions why, but the same answer. We don't know. That's what it comes down to. But the fact is, we believe it, and we believe it based upon. We think the Holy Spirit inspired our inspiration in our spirits that tell us that it's true. Now, it's a belief system, just like the evolutionist scientists have a belief system, or anybody else has a belief system. It's a belief system, and we that's our part of our faith. And I have a faith that one day, if God wants to explain it, it will be explained. It seems totally counter to the human experience, but then the human experience is totally flawed since the...
But how can the human experience be flawed if humans were made in the image of God? If humans are flawed, that means God is flawed. And if God is flawed...
Well, that's not necessarily true.
Why not?
This means that your finite mind cannot surround the infinite concept. There's a lot of things that are infinite we don't know. The mystery of iniquity that came into the world is one of them. God created everything perfectly, the Bible says, but this thing called the mystery of iniquity, again, it's just like something, how could something always have been and always will be?
Mm-hmm.
We don't know. We can't get
all right, thanks very much for joining us, Terry, and for sharing your views on the Nephilim imperatives. I don't know. If man is flawed and we were made in God's image, that means God is flawed. And if God is flawed, what does that mean about the entire concept? I believe, but I'd like answers. And so does the rest of the world, and this is why I say we're not sheep anymore. I'll be back on the other side of the commercial break with the news as the Exxon continues right here on Talk.